Hello, scholars. My name is Dr. Kara Stillen, and the goal of this channel is to make academic subjects easier to understand. In the last video, we covered part two of World War II, including the rise of power by Adolf Hitler in Germany, as well as Pearl Harbor. In this video, we're going to cover part three of World War II, so let's begin. When the Allies decided to concentrate their efforts in Europe first, specifically near France, this upset China and Russia. It was difficult for the Allied powers to align themselves with Russia because at one time, Russia was basically allowing the Nazis to take over the region without even resisting. Russia had also refused to repay war debts to the US, which made many Americans angry at Stalin and his regime. Roosevelt continued to improve relations with the Soviet Union, though, especially during the war. He made sure to directly supply Russia with war equipment once they'd entered the conflict. When Churchill and Roosevelt decided to fight the Axis powers near France, this left Russia to fend for itself against Hitler in the first many years of battle. The Soviet Union ended up fighting against more than 200 German divisions. This created a giant rift between the US and England with the Soviet Union. Dwight D. Eisenhower, who was the supreme commander in the US Army, believed that a frontal assault across the English Channel would be the best way to win the war against Germany. FDR agreed with this. This meant the US and Britain would have a full-scale attack on Europe by the early months of 1943, with a French beachhead established sometime in the fall of 1942. The British had a different approach. They wanted naval and air attacks to position themselves around the continent, with the majority of them in the Mediterranean Sea. This would make an eventual attack on the country of Germany much easier. The British ended up agreeing with the Americans, but pushed hard to begin the invasion with an attack in North Africa. In November of 1942, Allied troops landed on the coasts of Algeria and Morocco. And as described before, the Allied troops pushed the German troops into Egypt. Eisenhower was late in arriving with his troops, and America's first battle was in the desert just south of Tunis at the Kasserine Pass. The Americans were easily defeated. General Patton took hold of the soldiers and brought back their confidence, and in May of 1943, they pushed the Germans out of Africa. Surprisingly, the Soviet Union's Red Army had fought hard against the German army during the same months as the battles raged in Africa and had succeeded in the Battle of Stalingrad. Hitler sent division after division to no avail against the Russians. The Russians held them back each time and infuriated Hitler. After the Allies were successful in Africa, Churchill insisted their soldiers invade Sicily and then Italy in the middle of 1943. When Mussolini realized the Allies were extremely strong and would probably win in his nation, he fled to Germany for protection. The Germans sent in troops into the mountains near Rome. There were heavy casualties on both sides and no gains were made until 1944. The Russians continued to be successful at pushing the Germans out of their nation and reaping the rewards of their success. The U.S. plan for the Pacific portions of the war adopted island hopping as their strategy to capture Southeast Asia, China, and the Dutch East Indies. The plan created by Douglas MacArthur called for the movement of troops and the Navy to go from Australia to New Guinea and back to the Philippines. Admiral Chester Nimitz wanted to focus on Japanese islands and the Central Pacific. It was thought that eventually these two plans would eventually meet in the middle for a final invasion of the Japanese islands. In May of 1942, the American Navy blocked the Japanese when they tried to outflank Australia in the Battle of the Coral Sea. There was a change that took place in the Pacific portion of the war when the Battle of Midway began. Midway was about 1,000 miles west of Hawaii, and Japan wanted to take out the rest of the American fleet in that area. America's planes were about to shoot down the Japanese given long distances, which gave them an advantage. Japanese fighters managed to take out a mass of torpedo bombers, but a second wave of American planes were able to hit three Japanese carriers. At the end of the battle, America had taken out four Japanese aircraft carriers, whereas the Japanese had only managed to destroy one. This battle meant the U.S. finally had control of the Central Pacific. The Allies continued to launch offenses in the Solomon Islands and east of New Guinea in the middle of 1942. Thousands upon thousands of soldiers died from both sides, and they eventually drove the Japanese out of Guadalcanal. MacArthur now directed troops to forcefully drive the Japanese out of New Guinea. Eventually, the U.S. took back Gilbert, the Caroline Islands, Marshall, and the Philippines. As the U.S. eventually won back island after island, their hope was to establish themselves significantly in this area to halt future offenses. Like World War I, the U.S. nation could not have won the war without the enormous work that took place on the home front. American industry changed its manufacturing to benefit American soldiers fighting in various nations. Women moved into the workforce in large numbers, including married women. This quickly helped the nation to move out of the Great Depression as it put people to work and they bought the items their family needed. Franklin Roosevelt won a fourth term in the presidency in 1944, which probably didn't surprise most Americans. The War Production Board, WPB, was established in 1942 by President Roosevelt. Businesses could now claim tax credits for producing what the nation needed and developed contracts with the government. Certain resources like steel, aluminum, and copper were saved for military equipment, and rubber was extremely scarce at this point. In 1943, the administration called for the rationing of gas and to preserve the life of automobile tires because of the rubber. When America entered the war, its factories and industries were able to turn out two times as many goods as the Japanese and German industries combined. Workers often made two to three times what they were used to getting paid because of the overtime that they worked. Farmers also profited and their prices quadrupled. Some Americans saved their money or bought war bonds. Massive amounts of Americans left their hometowns in search of the best-paying jobs during World War II. This meant housing shortages in places where the best jobs were located. Many Americans converted their homes into boarding houses where people could sleep on cots set up in bedrooms. These Americans made a ton of money off the war boom. Families often suffered from very crowded living conditions. Daycares were extremely hard to find, and a lack of teachers existed in the U.S. Women gained economic opportunities during World War II, and some worked in steel mills with blast furnaces. Women showed that they could do the same work as men could. Their paychecks rose by 50% from the years of 1941 to 1943. The feeling of pride in one's work and for the war efforts were felt. When Black Americans were kept from seeing combat in World War II, A. Philip Randolph threatened a march on Washington in 1941. President Roosevelt didn't want any type of conflict within the nation and agreed to create a Fair Employment Practices Committee to help get rid of racial discrimination in war and war industries. It was after the development of this committee that employment rose greatly for Black Americans in various industries. The committee was small and could only take care of one-third of the complaints it received, but it was a start to ending the unequal treatment of Blacks in industry within the U.S. One of the worst detriments of World War II was the forced relocation of 120,000 Japanese Americans from areas near California. Extreme racial fears by Californians surfaced after Pearl Harbor toward Japanese Americans, and FDR approved of the military to relocate these Americans to concentration camps within the country's interior. Two-thirds of every detained Nazi, native-born Japanese American, was relocated due only to their ancestry. These Japanese Americans were forced to sell their farms and businesses at prices they would have never normally accepted. Not only did the Japanese lose their freedom, but they lost all that they owned. The government had built 10 detention centers in 7 various western and southern states where they survived in tar-papered barracks behind barbed wire and were observed by the American military. Any appeals to the Supreme Court did nothing. It was agreed upon by 1943 that if individual Nazi would pledge their loyalty to the U.S. and find a job away from the West Coast, they could be set free. About 35,000 Japanese Americans left the camps during the next 2 years, including more than 13,000 who joined the armed forces. More than 5,000 Japanese Americans renounced their American citizenship and chose to live in Japan at the war's end. The government did not close down the last detention center until 1946. There was no massive torture or extermination of any Japanese Americans in these concentration camps, but the treatment and conditions of these places were extremely disgraceful for those that were forced to live in them. In 1988, Congress voted to provide $1.2 billion for the estimated 60,000 surviving Japanese Americans detained during World War II. When Roosevelt was reelected to a fourth term, he chose Harry Truman as his vice president instead of Henry Wallace. Truman was more moderate and down-to-earth and was more acceptable to pretty much everyone within the Democratic Party. Those critics of Roosevelt politicized that FDR was too old and had too many health issues to continue forward in the presidency. President Franklin Roosevelt did suffer from congestive heart failure as well as high blood pressure. He didn't know it at the time, but when he accepted his fourth term in office, he had only months to live. Okay, well, we're going to stop part three there. I hope you enjoyed this video. Please don't forget to hit that subscribe button if you like the video. I'm going to jump into creating the fourth video so I can get that out to you ASAP. Thank you for watching, and I will talk with you soon.